So in Earth Science Analytics, we started working with machine learning for the last 4 or 5 years. And in this journey, now we have reached the stage where we are applying machine learning algorithms for automatic seismic interpretation. In this talk, we are going to examine different architectures and different strategies, and how these strategies, when we apply to a problem, automatic seismic interpretation problem, can impact the results we have, and give some ideas, because the future is the things in deep neural networks are changing very fast, and we have to be able to follow what's happening, all the trends, and try to see what we are going to use when you use these networks. The problem we are going to solve, we are going to discuss across the presentation, is coming. First, we have to acknowledge New Zealand Petroleum and Minerals providing this public 3D data from Parehaka. And the problem we are going to attack today is trying to map these channels here, which are quite difficult to hand track because they are covered by basalt surfaces. And the old way to track these channels was to try to go and hand pick them, which probably still happening. And the new way to approach this problem is try to say that I don't try to pick all this, everything here, but I want to pick only on some lines. And if I pick in these lines, can I make a network predict the rest of the channels on my system? And the problem I come here, the problem we're trying to solve is there are many networks out there. Which one can do the job we are looking for? So here I describe the methodology we are following for all the tests I'm going to present. So with the strain split blind, we have 18 cross lines that we test, 50 slices. Every 50 slices we get, we label one. We keep two blind, so we don't use it for everything. Everything we are going to show for reporting and understanding how good the network is working will be on these two blind cross lines. The strategy is that we crop all the slices in patches of 256 by 256, and we do some augmentation on randomly scanning the cube around to get patches that the network will be trained against. We put some noise on all data, so we introduce noise on our system to avoid the overfitting. Dropout is fixed 0.2 for all networks we are going to use. And we have approximately 100 to 150 epochs, so more than 100 epochs for each system we're going to see. And we're going to test here UNET, light UNET. I will discuss later what is this, segnet and light segnet, PSP, light PSP, deep lab version 3, and deep lab version 3 light. These are the architectures or networks, and these tests will be tested against different loss functions. So the weighted cross entropy, dice, and jacquard. So let's discuss about these networks. We are starting with this segnet. Segnet is the network introduced in late 2015. It was and it is still popular for two reasons. You can see it here. It is really very easy to implement in Python or any other language. It is actually, I think it is 10 lines of code, not more. You can see them here. So because of these 10 lines of code, everybody likes it, everybody uses it, and gives results. So we can have results from here. And it has one good thing. Here you can see the latent space. You can see about VAE and all this stuff. If you want to do any VAE, you need a latent space. So there is a latent space at this point, which is something that is an advantage for this system of this type of autoencoders. So what we do in our test, we use this segnet, as it was provided by the reference at the end, you will see it, as it was provided by the original abstract provoking when this was released. And then, because we had only 18 slices, and each slice had in total approximately less than 1 million pixels. So 18 slices times 1 million pixels is 18 million pixels training. And this segment here, as it was provided there, has 31 million parameters to be trained against. So it is a bit difficult to imagine that you will manage to have a network that has 31 million parameters to be trained with only 18 million pixels from your seismic. So that's why what we do, we introduce light segnet. And how we introduce light segnet, you can remove here one, this complete layer here. And then the standard filters, I think it is 32, 64, 256, 512. Instead of doing these filters, we reduce also the number filters on each of these. So you can actually adjust the size, both in deep, also on the filters of each layers, and produce a smaller network. So we're going to discuss about three variations of this segment, and also three variations of each network we're going to discuss later, trying to see how different size of networks can understand the geology of the problem we're trying to solve. So then we go to the next architecture, which is quite stable, quite state-of-the-art also, although it was released in 2015. If you go into medical imaging, you will see that most publications are happening using this unit. It is fantastic, it is simple. It is exactly like segnet. You can see segnet going down, but the magic here comes from these concatenations. So actually what you do, when you have here your encoder, you take information and concatenate this to the decoder with these channels. And this, for 3 years, from 2015 until 2017, 2 years, was outperforming any other network out there. And it's still very reliable and still very good. I have here some IOUs. This is a VOC library of competition. They provide millions of pixels to be able to classify and then take some scores. You can see here this had 0.6 score. Unfortunately, this is not. I haven't found the score of this on VOC, but I found in a very similar one. But I skip it because I go to the next architecture, which is the PSPNet, which was actually the winner of the Imagent competition in 2017, the year it was released by Google. And this is changing now the architectures. Now, also you can see here you cannot have here latent space. There's no latent space here. So if you want to be accurate, what I see. Latent space is very difficult. It is for another purpose. So if you want to do this mapping, you have to work like this. So what they did here, they put this information, and now what they did here, they changed the system. So they actually used here a common CNN. In the original paper, it is a ResNet, and ResNet is huge. It's, I think, 30 million only for the feature extraction. And then they get this feature extraction there, and then they have a pooling. And what they do, why they manage there to win, because they put these 1, 2, 3, 4 different CNNs that they are able to look. You can see the size. They are looking also the big image and the small image out of your slice. And this outperformed everything. When they come there, they outperform everything. So then we are going to test this one. And then also we're going to, because again, this original is, I think it's around 40 million parameters to be trained. We are going to reduce the size. How? We are going to reduce the features, the size of the CNN here on the feature extractor. And also we are removing here one layer, and we are also reducing the filters here. And try to see also how this can work. And then the final one we're going to test is this deep lab. Version 3 plus, because Google started with DeepLab version DeepLab, then they had V3, and now they have V3 plus. And why this plus? Because they introduced this here. So DeepLab is exactly like PSPNet. They do the same. I mean, everybody goes, see what the previous happened. and they just go and they put here, they change the atrus convolution. They don't have the convolution we had in the beginning, but they do the atrus convolutions, and then they push, they take the same extractions here on different to see the different name, but the atrus convolution has the benefit that can go and don't have stride one, but see it is a delayed network, so can scan sparsely the image. And this went the score from 85 to 87. 2% is a lot on this problem, because we are talking about 30 million of pixels, so it's really a lot, a big improvement. A month ago, we have a new winner here. It was too fast to be implemented from us, but will be in the next weeks. So now let's see all this, what I discussed. Now, we have some truth labels here, and these truth labels, we mean labels that have been labeled by human experts. And so I take this, I show these two blind slides that we have not used anywhere. And we are going to study in detail this, how the network works here, there, 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 and here, which is something challenging. More important will be what's happening here during the slides. So I urge you to look at this one. And also this one. Why? Because here we have this step in the channel, and here we have these stops, you see. So will the network be able to follow and make one channel here, then stop there, and so on? So I go into segnet. So here I have the segnet with the 29 milli parameters, which performed very well. When you train on your training data set, it performed very well. I will show the results. But when I go into the blind, it fails massively. Why? It is, I could have tried to put a high dropout, I could have tried to go into a large epoch size. It's too large. It's too large and it's not able to represent what's really happening. So, and you can see that the same network, when we reduce the parameters, it does much better. And when you reduce more, maybe we have something here better, but you will see also on the result, we fail badly here. So, but we knew this, that segnet will not manage very well. But we have it here because everybody uses it, so he should be aware when he uses it what the impact of using it as it is. So here are the results. So you can see here we have three bars always. The first one is the blind, the first blind slice, the second blind slice, and the third one is the validation. And you can see that the 29 milli parameters, the full size segment, actually performed worse for both the 2 milli parameters and the 300K parameters. So it doesn't make sense to use, if you have so small data set, doesn't make sense to use such big nets. You can go much smaller, it will be faster, and you probably gain in accuracy when you go into blind. Unless you try a lot to teach it and not to overfit everywhere. So, and then we test again segnet, but now we change the loss function. Loss function is important. If you see all the winners in the competitions, what they are going to do is they are going to train against different loss functions, not one. Nobody has ever won training on one loss function. Everybody will do a combination or a sequence of loss functions. That's why I'm coming here and I say, okay, I have the truth. We have here the light one, because probably is the best from what we have seen before. And then we introduce the dice loss function and the Jacquard loss function. Both of them are trying to maximize the IOU. They have some intersection parameter in the top, and then they are changing on the denominator. So you will see what I go fast. I have five, so I go fast. You will see that when we go on this dice and Jacquard, what happens, we underestimate. Look, the network performance will go very well. You will have a nice loss function. You will see that everything stabilized for all these three. All these three will have a fantastic result. So you will say that here you get one outcome, here another and another. What has changed? Only the loss function. And everybody is happy. but you have done some certainly underestimation here, and here some overestimation. Segment is not good result. If we are here, you can see much better. Why? Because unit is better. So we go directly on what we discussed before, and you see here we don't have the problems with the light unit on these places. On this one, things are okay. You see here it splits. Here it managed to go well. You can see here the split definitely. Everything looks okay here. And we are on the same range of parameters, around 2 million, like before. Not 31 as the original, so 10 times less. And if you go on the original, the maximum you actually lose, and you see it here, this is the original. Because it is very high scores here, I have the range here is different, but you can see that the light one outperforms on both light both blind slices, and also on the final one. Why? Because if I want to make this yellow go high, I have to train for a long time and try to do a lot to stabilize things. I go very, so here you can see exactly same behavior like discussed before on the light units with the dice and the Jacquard loss, and you can see again the underestimation where we are trying to minimize you on these losses. I will go on the PSP. Again, now we have 12 million parameters, the original one. We have used 1.5 on the light, and then we had also a very small, the ultra light, 300K parameters. You can see that still, it is better architecture. You can see even that with 300K parameters, you can capture things much better than the previous one were able to capture when they had this number of parameters. You have to remember also to always have that this 18 slices with approximately 18 million points that we are drawing here black and white because it is challenge or not challenge. But on the background, it is the seismic data that we are mapping. So here are the PSP results. And again, I guess you can see that here you can have underestimation, but much less. So the difference between the light PSP and the light PSP with the dice loss is considerably less, although you can see when we do cross entropy weighted, we have an overestimation, which is nice. You know, the geologists will say, okay, it is very nice, the body is very nice because everything is clear and you can see it very, very, very nice here. And finally, we go into deep lab. I had to go to exception, feature exactly in the front end because the mobile net is very small by definition, and then I was not able to have this large one. So we have this with 41 million parameters, this 1.5, and this with 650K. And you can see same results like PSP. We are improving, always improving. Why? We are going time ahead, and new ones will come that will outperform what we had in the past. Although I have to admit that the changes from light, from unit into PSP are not that much. So light unit is still a network that is really very good to be applied. And it is simple to implement, and it is very easily adjustable. So here you can see the underestimation when we have the deep lab on the dice on the loss functions. I have a comparison here, first is segment, light unit, the PSP, and the deep lab. I go into conclusions. So on limited data set, large networks will overfit probably. So they don't guarantee large networks that exist with hundreds of millions parameters. Because our data set is probably small, they don't guarantee better performance. We have to revisit segment architectures if they are not using for VAE, because VAE is important in our science, and if we, it's maybe the best we can use today for this purpose. So smaller networks are easier and cheaper to train. Weighted cross entropy loss slightly tends to overestimate volumes of unbalanced class. The unbalanced class here is the channels. In this slice, it was less 1% of the slice covered by channel. The next 99% was actually background. And dice and Jacquard loss slightly tends to underestimate volumes of unbalanced classes. So it is important to see, to check the size of the network when we try to implement it somewhere. These are the results when we applied everything that I'm finishing. So what we can see in Earth Science Analytics, that the automatic seismic interpretation reduces the cycle of interpretation time. we can improve the quality of interpretation in complex geological data, and ready for questions.